When contemplating the many options hidden within the great filter solutions to the Fermi Paradox, there are several benchmark ones in the history of Earth that really seem that if they had not happened as they did, none of this would be here, and Earth would still be a life-bearing world today, but a much more primitive one than what we actually have. Often, all of these solutions are put under the title of the Great Filter Solution, but in reality, they are actually solutions to the Fermi Paradox in and of themselves. And the Great Filter is merely an umbrella. This particular one could be called the Complexity Problem, and it goes like this. Life is everywhere, but it's rarely complex. This is actually a complicated solution because any of a number of things could happen to create such a situation. And sometimes what seems like a true great filter actually turns out to not really be one. This was the case with the prokaryotic to eukaryotic leap, which seemed like a strong candidate for a great filter. After all, how often will one organism consume another and not digest it? But as it turns out, it's a weak filter, as new information on how symbiosis between microorganisms occurs has developed. It may just have been a common outcome of certain situations of symbiosis with microbes, and that was it. So goes the great filter. In short, nature can and often does surprise, and that affects most solutions to the Fermi Paradox in this grain. Something may seem difficult and unlikely, but it turns out not to be once you know more. One such solution involves a very unusual, very unique occurrence in the history of life on Earth. Known as the Cambrian explosion, this process began about 538.8 million years ago, at the beginning of the Cambrian period, which kicked it off actually, and it's unclear just what happened to start it. The problem is that before this time, the fossil record is sparse, but it seems as though all of a sudden, many of the major animal phyla that we know today suddenly appear at about the same time. Moreover, this period only lasted from about 13 to 25 million years, less than how far in time we are since the extinction of the dinosaurs. Yet it left Earth a radically changed, very diverse biosphere that continues today. Though in fairness, the picture is not complete here, and some scientists have suggested extending the explosion to a bit earlier of a period, because it's somewhat ambiguous as far as the data goes. But before the explosion, life was still fairly simple on Earth, though quite a bit more complex than even earlier periods. There were lots of unicellular organisms, but also small multicellular ones that sometimes would organize themselves into colonies. And there are some indications of something more complex. This odd period was actually known fairly early on in the history of modern science, noticed in the fossil record as early as the 1840s. And Darwin even mentions it in his seminal book, On the Origin of Species, noting that it may have constituted a problem for his hypothesis of natural selection. One of the many problems here is that not only is the fossil record extremely incomplete, the further back you go, the worse it gets. Fossils are rare occurrences to begin with, and weathering and metamorphism of rock destroys their deposits. Fossilization is rare anyway, and then most fossils get destroyed. And beyond that, there's always a chance that the paleontologist might not come across it if it does exist because it's buried in some rock they didn't get to see. Paleontology really is a science of luck. All you can really do is try to assemble broad overviews of the history of life on Earth. In the Precambrian, it's difficult to know exactly what was going on that might have led to the subsequent Cambrian explosion, because it's possible that the evidence needed just wasn't preserved or was destroyed by time. Key information can be lost in a paleontological context because of this, especially when you're looking at a specific event. And there are even more complications. There actually is a bias in the fossil record. Fossils form and do form differently in different environments. Soft tissues are very rarely preserved, so you find lots of skeletons and shells, teeth and peripheral footprints and so on, but very rarely any indications of soft tissue, though it does occasionally happen. This leads to a strange fact. We know of over 30 phyla of animals living today, but in the fossil record, a full two-thirds of them aren't found. It's not because they weren't there, it's because the conditions needed to preserve their fossils to today in order to be found just weren't there. This brings up a problem that may actually be common to all alien species in the universe. Fossils seem likely on worlds with liquid water oceans, which obviously is a good solvent for life. We actually see sedimentary rocks on Mars that were laid down originally as ocean sediments. So the basic mechanism for forming fossils is probably common on terrestrial water-bearing worlds. There may well be alien paleontologists out there, studying fossils to piece together the natural history of their worlds, just like we do. But it's also just as likely that those exoplanets would also have weathering and geological processes that make their own fossil record as spotty as Earth, potentially more so. So what do? Well, at our current technological level, we go out, dig up fossils, prepare them, and put them in museums and collections to preserve them, and have them available for study. What might an alien scientist do that's vastly more advanced than we are? Well, they may send their fossils to space. The idea of setting up data farms in space to protect data, such as the collective history of your planet, really just amounts to computer data. There has been some talk of eventually doing this on the moon, and we already send out data of sorts in the form of things like the Voyager Records, which contain music that's likely to outlast any other medium where those songs are recorded. And we did that specifically just in case an alien species ever finds it, unlikely though that is. And we did that in the 1970s. We may be sending out space probes containing data about us for thousands of years more, so long as we survive. So what happens if an alien civilization has been doing that far longer? Would they send out their data? The reality is that they may simply conclude that anyone finding that data isn't going to be able to decipher it. So they may instead send out physical relics of their own natural history, in the form of fossils from their home world, perhaps even fossils of their own species. With the understanding that alien scientists are probably going to understand what they were looking at, because one commonality in the universe is likely to be geology. Another advantage is fossils, when properly protected, such as in an ark in space, will last indefinitely, many billions of years, than they would if they were being weathered on a planet. Plus, they are almost indestructible in space, so long as they aren't hit by anything. Though over time, they would, if unprotected, wear down from contact with dust in the interstellar medium. There are many wild cards in that speculation, however, such as species that only have soft tissue and never evolve anything analogous to bones or shells, or for that matter leaves, which do actually sometimes fossilize, that may leave few fossils, or civilizations that see no wisdom in exporting their natural history across the cosmos, but it's an interesting thought nonetheless. But back to the Cambrian explosion. There's yet another mystery here. Another clue in paleontology other than fossils are chemical markers in the geology that preserve some record of what was going on. For the beginning of the Cambrian, these markers show evidence that there might have been a mass extinction of something that wasn't preserved, or alternatively a huge release of methane clathrates in the oceans leading to a rise in temperatures. How that affected the Cambrian explosion that followed is unknown, but it seems awfully situational. At the same time, the markers might also be the result of the process of the explosion itself. It's still unclear. Also from the time before, a group of fossils known as small shelly fauna are found, and are dated as much as 10 million years before the onset of the Cambrian, which includes spines, armor plates, and tiny shells, not unlike clams, but very tiny, only 1 or 2 millimeters long, which again may suggest that the Cambrian explosion was not as much of a sudden explosion as was previously thought. Though it still seems out of place that so much happened in the early Cambrian so rapidly, even if the period in which it happened is extended. And then there is the mystery of the trilobites. These famous fossils, which are among the most popular fossils for collectors, actually have a mystery regarding them. They appear in the Cambrian strata about 530 million years ago. But it's clear that they must be much older, because the moment they appear, it looks something like walking into a room when a party's already been going for several hours. They were already diverse and developed by the time they show up, suggesting that there are more fossils of earlier trilobite species yet to be found. Or if not, all we see are the first moments in which they had exoskeletons, and their precursors did not have them. So the bottom line here is that the Cambrian explosion is murky. It's been pointed out that the whole thing may be a kind of bias, known as push of the past, that basically says that species tend to go extinct early, that don't experience a rapid rate of diversification. This would mean that it's illusory, and life was moving towards this complexity anyway, and a few things happened that allowed for survival and a perceived explosion. But there are other ideas if the explosion was indeed real. If there was an explosion, oxygen levels are one candidate for what happened. For the earlier eukaryotes, oxygen levels rising seems to have benefited them. Likewise, it may have benefited the evolution of the much more complex life of the Cambrian explosion. Another question is ozone. To shield life on Earth from ultraviolet radiation, an ozone layer is needed, and it may simply not have been enough until the Cambrian to allow for the explosion that would inevitably happen when enough of it was present. Others include a near freezing over of most of Earth that contracted genetics to the point that there was a pause, but that, if it happened, was a long time before the Cambrian and doesn't seem a good fit. Calcium levels in the ocean are another option, as are various biological explanations involving just how organisms develop physically. And those physical changes may be what allow the explosion, or even changes in the food chain, applying different pressures that led to it. And there have been a number of other ideas. But the bottom line is that within this, over and over, is the question of how situational it all seems, and how alien biospheres may not follow the same path, and as a result never actually see this huge radiation of biological diversity that happened over a very short period of time during the beginning of the Cambrian. What caused it remains a mystery, but it could well turn out that when that mystery is solved, if ever, it could collapse the Fermi Paradox as something that's not likely to happen very often. But at the same time, that doesn't eliminate the possibility that it could happen other ways, other paths, like the prokaryotic-eukaryotic leap. And it turns out that it's easier than we thought, and not a great filter at all. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing the trilobites suspiciously. When you really look at them, with all their diverse species and how complex they were, some of them with compound eyes and all sorts of interesting features, they're not completely gone from the Earth, and have been for many millions of years. Very fragile life on this world, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.